On the night of February 1st, 2002, Danielle Van Dam, a 7-year-old girl living in San Diego, California, was abducted by her neighbor and family acquaintance, David Allen Westerfield. That same evening, Danielle's mother, Brenda Van Dam, and her two girlfriends went out to a local bar named Dad's in the nearby city of Poway, California. Danielle's father, Damon Van Dam, stayed home to babysit Danielle and her two brothers. Damon remembers putting Danielle to bed at around 10:30 p.m. and went to bed himself shortly thereafter. Damon slept until his wife, Brenda, returned home at around 2 a.m. with her friends that she had gone out with that same evening. Brenda noticed something unusual upon her returning to the home. She noticed a light on the home security alarm panel system was flashing, indicating a disturbance or possible break-in surrounding the garage area. Brenda went into the garage and discovered that the side door had been left open. After chatting with her guests for approximately 30 minutes, Brenda's friends went home and Damon and Brenda Van Dam went to sleep shortly thereafter. Another hour passed before a second warning began flashing on the security alarm panel. This time, Damon Van Dam went to go check and noticed the alarm triggered was the sliding glass door leading to the backyard. He closed the door, checked the surrounding area, and went back to bed. More than likely, this is the moment that Westerfield had abducted Danielle and snuck out of the home, leaving through the sliding glass door and setting off the security alarm that awoke Damon Van Dam. The next morning, Danielle was discovered missing, which prompted her parents to call 911 at approximately 9:39 a.m. Law enforcement officials interviewed the Van Dams and their neighbors that Saturday morning of Danielle's disappearance. This is where they discovered that one neighbor, David Westerfield, was not home at around the time that police interviews were being conducted. On the Saturday morning of Danielle's disappearance, Westerfield retrieved his luxury motorhome, stocked it with supplies, and left home at 9:50 a.m., 11 minutes after Brenda called 911 to report Danielle missing. On his way home on Monday morning, a sleepy-looking and barefooted Westerfield stopped at his regular dry cleaners and dropped off two comforters, two pillowcases, and a jacket which would later yield traces of Danielle's blood. When law enforcement individuals first interviewed Westerfield, he did not mention going to the dry cleaners, although he detailed almost every other stop on his weekend outing. David Allen Westerfield was a 49-year-old self-employed engineer and had no criminal record at the time. He was a divorced father of two college students and lived two houses away from the Van Dams. About 3 days before Danielle's disappearance, Danielle and Brenda Van Dam sold Girl Scout cookies to Westerfield after he invited Brenda and Danielle into his home to show them his remodeled kitchen. Danielle became the subject of intense search efforts with hundreds of volunteers searching various deserts, highways, and remote areas for weeks on end. On February 22, 2002, police arrested Westerfield for Danielle's kidnapping after two small stains of her blood were found on his clothing and in his motorhome. Westerfield's lawyer, Stephen Feldman, argued that no evidence of Westerfield was found in the Van Dam residence. In rebuttal, Dusek, the Van Dam's attorney, argued that it is plausible for an intruder to enter a home without leaving trace evidence, especially if he is taking appropriate precautions. Conversely, Dusek argued that the nature and volume of Danielle's trace evidence in Westerfield's home, motorhome, and jacket allow no reasonable explanation other than guilt. On February 27, 2002, two searchers found Danielle Van Dam's body. Danielle was completely nude and partially decomposed near Dehesa, California, a town that is 30 miles east of San Diego, California. Because of the condition of the body, the coroner was unable to determine a cause of death or whether she was sexually assaulted and had to use dental records to confirm her identity. Westerfield pleaded not guilty and went to trial on June 4, 2002. The forensic evidence presented by the prosecution included Danielle's blood stains on Westerfield's jacket and blood found on the floor of his motorhome. There were also fingerprints from Danielle in his motorhome, hairs from the Van Dam family dog on Westerfield's motorhome bed comforter, and hairs consistent with Danielle's on the sheet of his bed. The trial lasted 2 months and concluded on August 8, 2002. On August 21, 2002, the jury found Westerfield guilty of first-degree murder, kidnapping, and possession of child pornography. A rumor reported by the media involved unnamed police sources claiming that Westerfield's lawyer was just minutes away from negotiating a plea bargain when a group of private citizen searchers found Danielle's body. According to these reports, under the plea bargain deal, Westerfield would have taken police to the site where Danielle's body was located in exchange for a sentence of life without parole. The penalty phase ended on September 16, 2002, when the jury rendered a verdict of death against Westerfield. In January 2003, Judge William Mudd sentenced Westerfield to death. Westerfield is currently incarcerated at San Quentin State Prison while his appeal is pending. Because of the continuing 2006 moratorium on executions and the 2014 ruling on the unconstitutionality of the death penalty in California, and it is unknown when or if Westerfield will ever face execution. Fortunately, Danielle's memory is very much alive and honored. An overpass on Interstate 8 freeway in San Diego, California has been named the Danielle Van Dam Memorial Overpass. It is near the location where her body was discovered by the search and recovery team. It's been more than 17 years since Danielle's murder, but her story has led to increased levels of crime awareness in San Diego's neighborhoods, as well as the institution of funds and benefits made in Danielle's honor. Her family still lives in Southern California and have formed a Danielle Legacy Foundation. The foundation works to promote volunteerism that will initiate positive changes that will put our children's safety first. Danielle Van Dam would have celebrated her 21st birthday on September 22nd, 2015.